Beloved, you are listening to Grace Life Comey Podcast, a platform commissioned by God to raise men into completeness in Christ Jesus. We believe that you will be blessed beyond measure as you give yourself wholly to this divinely inspired teaching. Through God's servant Pastor Chimdi Ohahuna. Grace to you. Jesus is Lord.
We give God praise for another day, another opportunity to study the Word of God. And this is Word Explosion 2023. It's happening this year. We thank God for the experience thus far. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
God has been helping us study the 7th verse of John chapter 9.
Yeah.
Just to God that soon we'll move on. Amen. But we'll be receiving great light thus far from study.
Yeah.
Amen. And just a reminder, we have been using the 26th translation,
yeah,
you know, of the New Testament.
Yeah.
So it's really a great resource using to use, you know, we just look at the little variations in the translations,
yeah,
and just to get deeper understanding in James 6.
Yeah.
All right. So to proceed into today's session, let's pray.
Sweet Holy Spirit, we bless you. Our Father, we glorify you. Jesus, we extol you. Thank you for another time of fellowship in your presence again.
Yes,
thank
Lord.
You for what you have been doing in the past 6 days. We trust you again to teach us, to grant us understanding today again. Our eyes of understanding be enlightened today. Thank you, sweet Spirit of the living God, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Hallelujah. Forever, oh, your word is settled in heaven. Is settled.
All right, we're going to be finishing up what we started up yesterday. We're looking at WMS translation. It says, everyone through him might come to believe. All right, we looked at the word come, and we basically climaxed at the point of Emuna yesterday, which is the faith of God, the faith wherein, which is bigger than life itself, which is bigger than belief itself, that is actually the faith of God. Faith, the faith of God is a faith that is bigger than you, bigger than me, bigger than our very existence. Are we together?
Yeah.
The faith that we live and die for. The Apostle Paul says, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. This is the operation of the faith of God. The Bible says, have the faith of God. As when James says, have faith in God. But the original Greek says, have the faith of God. Are we together? That's the faith we're talking about here. That's what we are meant to have. That will communicate salvation through us. Amen to Jesus.
Amen.
By our human faith, by our sensual faith, we receive salvation. But we are not meant to remain at the realm of our sensual faith. We are meant to now operate at the faith of. And this formed by the continuous renewing of our mind, that aligning our soul to what our spirit, which operates in. When this becomes our reality, we discover that we live and die for no. The faith we have in God, the revelation of Jesus, Lamb, and the light of God. Now, we understood that on an individual note yesterday. That is actually what we are doing in this. That's where we are doing. That's all we are. As one of the Christians, that's all we are doing here. We're just going to fully manifest the faith of God. Amen to Jesus. And now, when the church comes to this place, we attain the unity. You know what I'm saying? Now, we looked at this as an individual. Now, we have always looked at it on the plate. I always believe in the corporate church, the body of Christ. I believe so much in the body of Christ. Over the years, we've been putting ourselves as individuals. We will not come to the point of understanding of we as a body. The body, the understanding of the body, very important, because it will make us see things in a different light. When we understand the unity, understand the body of Christ. So, you know what I'm saying? And so when the church comes to this place, we attain the unity of knowledge of the Son of God. become perfect. That's become mature. When we talk about perfect, you're talking about mature. Amen to Jesus.
Amen.
Yeah, perfection is our spirit man is born perfect, is perfect, like you know. When we attain perfection on this earth, as we mature, you know that, as we mature by aligning our soul to our spirit in Jesus, we become mature, and then we attain the status of fullness Christ. See, each of us attaining this is important. We are attaining it as a body. Is very much paramount and important. Because that is the church that Jesus is coming from, glorious church. God has attained what fullness is without spots. We keep reiterating this because we believe in the glorious church, believe in the glorious mega church, believe in this church. And we know that we see it happen here on earth. So we have started talking about it. Praise God. People say, but there's so much the church is having. So I agree with you, I do not disagree. But don't forget that it is his church. And you get what I'm saying? If they say he's going to come for a glorious church, then we believe his word. And you say that it's going to take long. You don't have the right to the time. Even Jesus said, for the time. Says the Father that knows the time. One of the signs of one of the proof that his time will come is that the church that is glorious make a church. Praise God forevermore. And that duration, I don't know. You don't know. I cannot put a time lag on it because it is God. And just do what he wants to do. Are you getting what I'm saying? And we can just see the margin suddenly. Are you getting me? It's God. Praise God forevermore.
Hallelujah.
So what we do is we keep walking and trusting, believing towards the emergence of the glorious mega church. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 13.
Ephesians 4:13 says, till we all come in the unity of faith,
beautiful,
and of the knowledge of the Son of God,
yeah,
unto a perfect man,
yeah,
unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of
faith. Beautiful. Glory to God forevermore.
Hallelujah.
The unity of faith. I believe too much in the unity of faith. Whenever a teaching is devised, no matter how revelation you see it, it's still not isolated. Are you getting what I'm saying? Even Paul said there were some who were, he called them crazy, they were crazy in their way of preaching. He said, but there were some who were preaching Christ in a very wrong manner, and you know, they were preaching not in the way that was meant to be preached. But he said, but he's happy, at least Christ is being preached. That was his at least Christ being preached. You know, that understanding will help a lot of us in the day of Christ, especially teachers of the word of God. And because when you see a lot of things that are happening today, you know, aches the heart. But at the end of the day, we should just be thankful to God that happens. But no matter how they are going about it,
Christ is
being. They are mentioning the name Jesus.
Yes.
At the end of the day, when they present it wrongly, the Holy Spirit will still brood over the hearts of the people that have been taught, and he'll be able to communicate the truth to them by himself. Even though the people that are speaking it, they're speaking it wrongly, but the Holy Spirit can always communicate right here and there. So we must be thankful to God that Christ, in that way, we do not fight ourselves, not war against. Are you getting what I'm saying? Jesus' disciples came and they told him, we saw some people casting out demons. He had not yet died and resurrected them. So we saw people casting out demons in your name. And we wanted to stop them. What did you actually have? Are they for you? Are they against you? And he said, anyone that is not against us is for us. So it means that these guys were not associated with the 500, let alone the 120, let alone the 70, let alone the 12. They were not in the group. Are you getting what I'm saying? But they were using the name of Jesus.
They were not disciples.
They were not disciples, as it were. They were not the called, the 12 called. They were not in the 12th circumference.
Oh, they were not following Jesus.
Exactly, as it were. But they were using the name, and Jesus said, they are using the name, they are not against us. Let them be, praise God forever. If Jesus said that, then who are we to now start, you know, fighting? Because Jesus now went further and said that he wants to bring those that are those sheep that are not in the sheepfold. So it means that there were people that were believing, but they were not in the group of the 500. Jesus said, I want to bring them in. Amen. And so it's important that we do not keep divisive, we do not preach in manners that disunite the body. We are to seek the unity of faith. And when we come to the point of emuna as a corporate body, denominations will not divide us. Doctrines will not divide us. Peter said, no prophecy in scripture is subject to his own faith. He was people himself. No prophecy in scripture is subject to his own private interpretation. Are you getting what I'm saying? I know that the Bible is all about prophecies. Are you getting me? The Bible says the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. So as we talk about Jesus, as we testify about Jesus, we are using the spirit of prophecy. And even as we are deciphering the revelation of private Jesus, none of us still have the sole right, are you getting what I'm saying, the private interpretation of the revelation of Jesus. It must be what? Iron sharpening. That is why the unity of faith is very important. Praise God forevermore.
Hallelujah.
And the unity of faith is this is the end of the journey of living in Jesus' church. That's the end of our journey. As individuals, yes. As a body, yes. So we must crave seriously to say the body attains. We thank God for bodies that are put together to this end. You know, like Nigeria, Christian Association of Nigeria, you have the Assemblies for Nigeria and the likes, and you get what I'm saying. Thank God for these bodies. You know, they are very beautiful. The purpose of these bodies is meant to be for us to attain the unity of place of immune, the faith of God at work in us, believers, not together. Where we will believe, Apostle Paul said that you say the same thing. Point where we begin to say the same thing. It's very important for us. And this is the journey we keep journeying. And when we get to this point, we have arrived at the end. And you ask me, are we going to arrive? Yes, we are going to arrive. That is the glorious church. That's the glorious church. We're going to arrive there. Glorious church, we're going to arrive there. When is it going to happen? I don't know. But Jesus said in the glorious truth. Now, for the first, it's about the unity of faith. And since I've said so, it means that we'll get to that point. And we're gradually getting there. You see, when all the heated arguments, we see all the heated arguments, at the end of the whole finish of the heated arguments, some of us begin to, many of us are now begin to come to a point and say, but anyway, I listened to someone and he said, Apostle Paul said, so long as Jesus is finished. I'm like, oh wow, I'm sure you are saying this. After all the heated argument, all the heated childhood, and all the heated, we will still come to this point. Every one of us will come there. And then we'll attain Muna. At that point, the church becomes the bride of Jesus coming for praise God forever. Hallelujah to Jesus. All right, so we all keep renewing our minds as individuals so that when we come as a corporate body, we can attain the unity of it. Praise God forevermore. All right, so today we're going to be going over to the last translation, the BAS translation. For the John chapter 1 verse 7b. Now we're going to be looking at what BAS has to say. Amen to Jesus. All right. Says, so that all men might have faith in. The others were talking about believing. But BAS categorically stated faith. That all men might have faith in him. And the King James and other versions rendered belief. Holy Spirit, we have to revelation into your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Yeah, and rendered belief. And you see, it's important to believe from everybody's perspective what they're saying. You know what I'm saying? Now, but BAS rendered faith. Renders faith. You know, when we talk about faith, many of us have faith. Many of us have faith. So the faith, the teaching of faith has spread, and we thank God for that. Thank God for Spirit. We go spot, we thank God for Kenneth E. Peggy. You know, he's called the 20th century father of faith, thought of faith, and we bless God. Every of us who must have studied on faith, must have believed, we must have used his materials. You know what I'm saying? Did an exhaustive study on faith, and we are still learning beautiful and simple studies on faith that we can use to believe this. You know what I'm saying? So I'm not going to be saying so much on faith today. And I've also done teachings on faith. We went to Jesus over podcast, you see, not teaching. So I'm not going to be talking about, you know, so much of faith today, because we want to start doing that. We're going to start a new series, and that will make us not continue to this. Not to continue. So go on our podcast. You see all that teaching we've done on faith. Can I tell you this much of faith? You can learn on faith. You know what I'm saying? All right, now. So what BS talks about faith. This means that faith in Jesus as the Lamb and the light of God was attained through John the Baptist. You know, we've understood that in our previous studies on this particular verse. You know, we've understood that in our previous studies in this particular verse, you know, that it was through John the Baptist that faith in Jesus as the Lamb and the light of God was attained. Go over the previous studies and you'll be able to, you know, get those teachings and you help yourself with that, okay? Thus, it is not enough to know that Jesus is the Lamb and light of. It's not just enough to know. Are you getting what I'm saying? It's not enough to know. You see, many of us know. Many of us know that Jesus, there's this head knowledge of Jesus. Many people have read about Jesus. Many people have had, you know, studies. It's not enough to know about Jesus. Many people have read about Jesus. Many people have read quite a lot about Jesus, both erroneously and let me use the word rightly. They are very about Jesus. When you go online, you see a lot about Jesus. But it's not enough to just know to read about Jesus. It's not even enough to have head knowledge about Jesus. It's not enough to hear about Jesus as the Lamb and the light of God. Praise God forevermore.
Hallelujah.
You know, many who were there while John the Baptist made this declaration in John chapter 1, verse 29. Let's read it again. Ready before? Let's read it again.
John chapter
1, verse 29.
The next day, John seeth Jesus coming unto him and said, Behold the Lamb of God, which taketh away the sin of the world.
Praise God forevermore. You know, so why John made this declaration? There were many people who were there. It was not just one or two people that were there. There were quite a number of people that were there. And were like, oh, behold, he said, Behold the Lamb of God. It was clear. It was precise. He was not prophesying. He was not speaking mysteries. Amen. It was a clear declaration. And he pointed to the person. He pointed to the person clearly. You know, it's not enough to know about Jesus, to read about Jesus, to get an information about Jesus. On the day John the Baptist declared Jesus as the Lamb of God, there were people there, they got the information, they knew. People went back home and said, oh, John actually declared the Lamb of God today. Do you know that John declared the Lamb of God today? You know, it was news and people were informed about that. So actually, it's not enough to be informed about Jesus. Praise God, praise God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah to Jesus. There is more to being informed about Jesus. There is more to just know that Jesus is the Lamb of God. Amen to Jesus. Praise God forevermore. Now, it's because when John the Baptist declared Jesus as the Lamb of God, there were other people that went beyond information. Why some just stayed at information? Why some just stayed at knowledge, head knowledge of Jesus being the Lamb of God? There were some others that went beyond the level of head knowledge and information. Praise God forevermore.
Hallelujah.
This is true because, you know, many people were informed that day. Good number of people were informed. The number I don't know. But only two of John's disciples followed Jesus due to this declaration that moment. Let's go over again to John chapter 1, verse 35 to 37. Ready before, let's read again.
35-37 says, again, the next day, after John's two of his disciples, and looking upon Jesus as he walked, said, Behold the Lamb of God. And the two disciples heard him speak and followed Jesus.
See that? Now, there were people there, but every other of the others, they were just fine with information. But these two disciples did not just stop at information level. They moved. They went further. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yeah.
They acted on that information they had received. Many of us have information about Jesus. We have information about the Bible. We are informed, you know, so much information. But believing is not just all there is to it. We must go further. Are you getting what I'm saying? Hearing is not all there is to it. Getting information is not all there is to it. Reminds me the story of a particular man who recited, full chapter of the book of Psalms, Psalm 119, that 90 chapter. And when he was through reciting it, when he finished reciting it, sat down and he lit a cigarette and said, like, what's the big deal? Are you getting what I'm saying? And it was obvious that he had head knowledge, but there was nothing beyond head knowledge. Praise God forevermore. Hallelujah to Jesus. So it's not enough to just know that Jesus is the Lamb of God. We're talking about Jesus the Lamb of God, Jesus the light of God. It's not enough to just know that Jesus is the Lamb and the light of God. We must take the next step, and which is what? Which is faith. And what is faith? Faith is action, not mere words or mental assets or knowledge. Are you getting what I'm saying? Faith is action. It's not just mere words. It's not a mental asset. It's not just knowledge. Faith is action. Now, so knowledge without action is not faith. Praise God forevermore. Information without action is not faith. You know, we've had people who have been in church over the years. We have Christians who have been very informed. They can actually analyze scripture. They can actually debate scriptures, but they do not act on everything they debate. They do not act on what they debate. Praise God forevermore. Analysis without action is paralysis. Praise God forevermore. So it's not enough to analyze scripture. It's not enough to know scripture. It's not enough to be fast in scriptures. We must be able to act from the scriptures we know. Praise God forevermore. Now, so mental assent and knowledge without action is not faith. We need to be informed about this. Knowing about Jesus, knowing scriptures, are we together? Without acting on scriptures is not faith. It's not faith. The Apostle James said, faith without works is dead. James 2, verse 20 and 26. Faith without works is what? Dead. 2:20-26
says, but thou know, O vain man, that faith without work is dead. And then 26 says, for as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without work is dead also.
Beautiful. Now, James here, if you we'll read from verse, you know, as we go on from verse, you know, we'll read from verse 21 to 24, you know, to really see what he was trying to emphasize. James was basically trying to make us understand something. Now, he uses the word faith here, and you get what I'm saying? And when you say the word faith, it's the Greek word pistis, which means believing, and you get what I'm saying? Now, so faith is actually believing, and you get what I'm saying? It's believing in something. You can have faith in anything, praise God forevermore. The believing above all in someone, praise God forevermore. Now, so James was making us understand here that if you believe not work, your belief out, it's dead belief. That is why I said analysis without action is what? Paralysis. You can analyze something that you actually know. You can only analyze something you know. You get what I'm saying? You can even analyze something you believe. But until you act on that analysis, that knowledge, you are dead. Paralysis, praise God forevermore. Hallelujah to Jesus. And so the disciples of John who followed Jesus operated in faith because they believed that Jesus is the Lamb and the light of God. And they acted on what they believed immediately. They didn't need too much information to act. Some of us are looking for so much information to act. Actually, most of the time when you are over-informed, you end up becoming partially deformed if you are not careful. Because too much of information, some of the times, it begins to give you overload to take action. This guy just said, behold,
mental constipation.
Behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the Lord. John, you mean it? John say, yes, all right, we are following the Lamb of God. You don't need too much analysis. So that when you want to understand, you're always told that in any endeavor, when you overanalyze situation, you may end up not taking action. Because in the course of overanalyzing, you go into the pros and the cons, and if in the journey of analyzing situations, you end up tilting towards the cons more than the pros. You end up tilting towards the disadvantages than the advantages. The risk factors become more glaring to you as negative factors.
So you end up not taking steps.
At the end of the day, you end up not taking steps. So most of the time, overanalysis always end up in paralysis. People who want to act always do not overanalyze. The information that they get is what they jump. You know, and people will say, but that is not right. That is not. You plan, you act. But when you overanalyze, you actually do not act. Peter, Jesus, if that is you, or walking on the water, bid me come. Jesus said, come. He said, okay. Since I heard his voice, I know my master's voice. Let me be sure he's the one speaking. And he heard the voice. Jesus said, okay. And he entered the water and said, come. Just like that. It sounded a little weird. But amongst all the disciples, Peter was the only one who walked on water. He achieved something that no other disciple could what? Achieve. Because he was ready to act without overanalyzing. One information was enough. I heard the voice of my master. It is him. So if it's him walking, that means I can walk. And he started walking. Praise God forevermore. The Bible says he began to sing. The Bible did not say he sang. We together. Praise God forevermore. Now, so these guys acted on what they believed. When John said this is the Lamb of God, they believed John. It also makes us understand that some of the people that heard that declaration did not believe. A large chunk of them did not believe. When John said, this is the Lamb of God, take away the sin of God, they didn't believe. Say, John has started talking again. So they didn't believe, number one. Number two, some believed, but and their belief just ended there. Okay, I agree. You know, mental assent is agreeing with God. But agreeing with God is not faith. Until you act on what you have agreed, you are not acting, if you are not in faith yet.
Yes.
So some others, some did not believe. Why some others, they agreed, all right. But it takes you acting on what you have believed, what you have agreed with God, for you to say you are walking in faith. Are you getting what I'm saying? And these two guys, out of the people that were there, were the only ones that immediately acted on what they believed. They took an immediate action. But I see, what we don't know about faith is that faith requires immediate action. When you try to delay the action, you may end up not acting at all. Because a lot of things begin to come up and give you reasons why you are not one. So once you believe, once you agree, you act. You don't wait to test the waters more. If Jesus had told Peter, come, and Peter said, let me put my leg first. You know the way people do, to put their leg to check the water. Let me check the temperature of the water. Or let me put my leg, my feet, to be sure that there is a solid foundation that Jesus is working on. So if I put my leg and my leg goes inside, then I know that this is really water. It's not a solid pedestal. It's not a solid surface. So I will not move. But Peter did not do any of those checks. What did he do? He immediately went in. So we know that we are working with faith. James was trying to make him understand that. Make us understand that. We know we are working with faith. Where work is added to our faith. Where action is added to our faith. But when the action is added, we're actually in paralysis. We're actually working in a dead analysis, or dead agreement, or dead assumption, or whatever, but it's actually dead. Praise God forevermore.
Like, just want to draw your attention to the parable that Jesus gave of the man who had two sons.
Yeah.
Instructed them to go do something. And one actually said it's not good.
Yeah.
You know, while the other said he was going to go.
Yeah.
So this is a situation of where we have one that is not agreeing and one that is not. And then one that is not agreeing but could be instant action.
Mm-hmm.
While there is one that agrees but is not instant action.
At all.
So their case was more of, you know, you might have issues believing, but once you believe, you can you agree and you act immediately. You know, and where we have believers who they feel if they are instant in agreeing,
yeah.
Okay, but when it comes to agreeing, and you know, from that parable, you understood that the one who said no but later went to was more, you know, the father appreciated that action.
Exactly.
Than the one who said he was going to do it but never ended.
Exactly.
So we must be, yes, we may differ in our agreement time, you know,
exactly.
To the word of God and what God says. But what matters more is that we act as soon as we
agree. It's not about who agrees earlier.
Exactly.
Who believes earlier.
Mm-hmm.
Who believes later. What matters most, who acts. Who acts. So you may believe before me, but when I act before you, that's what matters.
Yeah.
You may agree before me, but when I act before you, that's what matters. So Christians should not be keen about who knew Jesus first. Who heard the word first. Who got the revelation first. My brother, who acted first is what matters.
Yeah.
Who acted first. It's not about who got the revelation first. Who heard first. Who knew first. Who read first. Who analyzed first. No. That's not what we're looking at here. We're looking at who acted first. Action is what is the proof of faith. Action is the proof of belief. So somebody might have heard, you know, yesterday and chose to act. Might have heard five months ago and just chose to act. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And somebody might have heard and believe and refuse not to act. The most important thing is acting. Praise God forevermore.
Hallelujah.
Now, so faith is acting on what you believe. Justification by faith is attained when action is added to it. The Bible says, "With the heart man believes unto salvation, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation." So, if you only believe and you don't confess, you are not saved. Believing is the work of the heart. Are you getting what I'm saying? But confessing is the work of the mouth. Until that confession is done, salvation is not enacted.
That confession is the
action. It's the action. It's the action that is added to your believing. So you can't just claim and say, I believe. We've heard people say there's nothing like altar call in the Bible. I will not disagree with you. Are you getting what I'm saying? But everybody must confess the Lordship of Jesus. You cannot just say, when you finish preaching, leave them to believe. And then when they believe, they confess anytime they want to confess.
They may never end up confessing. Yes. And you know, those kind of believers that are left to themselves, you know, to confess whenever they want to confess, they may end up not confessing.
They may end up not confessing.
And they will live in the delusion that because they keep receiving,
they keep receiving
the word. Just keep receiving and they believe the word. And that's fine. They will not see the aspect of the action
of confession.
And
salvation.
When they don't do that, they don't know that there's risk of no salvation.
Exactly.
So you may be in the water, you may be getting wet, but what keeps others, you know, surviving in water? You won't have it.
Exactly. Just like the popular thing that we say, how can I be in water and soup in heaven? Mm-hmm. So when you are believing and you do not confess. You'll be in water, mm-hmm. but soup will be empty. How? I don't know. You get what I'm saying? So that's why we take this step of making people confess the Lordship of Jesus. Because until confession is added to their belief, their salvation is not enacted. Praise God forevermore.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah to us. And so it's very, very, very important The work part of faith is very important. You cannot remove it. No, James made us understand it clearly again in the same James chapter 2. Let's look from verse 21 to 24.
21 to 24 says, was not Abraham our father justified by works?
Exactly.
When he had offered Isaac's son upon the altar.
Mm-hmm.
22 says, seest thou how faith wrought with works, and by works was faith made perfect.
Mm-hmm.
And 23 says, and the scripture was fulfilled, which said, Abraham believed God, and said unto him righteousness.
Mm-hmm.
And he was called father, the friend of God.
Mm-hmm.
So 24 says, ye see then how that by works a man is justified, and not by faith only.
He didn't say a man is not justified by faith, but say by faith only. Just believing alone, because like I said clearly, faith, the word pistis in the Greek, one of the major words that explains is believing. Just believing alone will not justify it. You have to add work to your believing. And the work is not a legalistic work. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's still a work of faith still. That's the beautiful thing about it. The work is a work of faith. See, the faith is believing. And the work is also faith. So it must be faith. The work is a faith-generated work. So when Jesus told Peter, come, it was Peter believed in Jesus. And he asked him, for his proof of belief was, it that be you biblical. And Jesus told him, come. So his faith, his work was generated by the come of Jesus. Is that not so? If Jesus did not tell him, come, Peter would have not, no matter how sanguinish Peter was, if Jesus did not tell Peter to come, Peter would have not stepped into that water. Peter would have chilled out in the boat there. And you get what I'm saying? For him to have stepped in it up because he heard the master tell him, come. So our work must be generated by faith. So when the work is not generated by faith, it will still be tantamount toward destruction at the end of the day. So the question is, how people say, oh, I saw in church, somebody gave a dangerous seed, and he came back to testify of how the dangerous seed provided produced a dangerous fruit and a dangerous harvest. And he, the person in question, went and sowed a dangerous seed. And after sowing a dangerous seed, he lost it. He was frustrated. He was confused. The dangerous seed never produced any dangerous fruit, neither, let alone a dangerous harvest. The question was, the person who sowed that dangerous seed we're talking about, his faith produced a work. It was an instruction. Are you getting what I'm saying? Peter came at an instruction. Are you getting what I'm saying?
I mean, why are we not asking why the rest of the disciples, not just, I mean, they were not told people. When Peter said, I go fishing.
They said, we come around.
They said, we come.
Uh-huh.
So when he was going into the lake, he's initially to the walk. Why didn't they find Peter?
Exactly. And this is where a lot of this information you have said is very important, because this is where a lot of time we miss it in church.
Mm.
It works for one person, does not mean that it's a blueprint for everybody. Because we've heard people see things on, we've created doctrines from the results of one believer.
Mm.
So I gave a seed of so $1,000 and I got so $1,000 return. And he said, now that means this is the way we have to follow it. And we see one or two testimonies and we are just jumping into it our way. Even the disciples know that this is working for Peter, it doesn't mean to work for us.
Yeah.
Let us work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. Peter, work out your own. You get what I'm saying? It brings to the fact that every work of faith must be generated by faith. And remember, Romans 10, verse 10, faith cometh by hearing and by hearing the word of God.
Yeah.
Peter could only act on what he believed because he heard the word from God, the word of God, which was Jesus speaking to him. You get what I'm saying?
Yes.
So until that faith is generated by the word, and the action is also generated by the word, you cannot get results from that faith. So it must, the faith, the action must be generated by the faith, and the faith must be generated by the word.
So faith always requires work generated.
Exactly. As simple as that.
The faith aspect is there, but it must go with work generated.
Exactly.
And not just any kind of
work. Not just any kind of work.
When everybody is doing it, then you do it. It's not faith. It's not work generated.
No. You don't file behind those that did it because they say they are doing that. They say they are getting results. No. This work, it must be generated by the faith you have. So if you say that you are not, the faith is not generating the work, my brother, say with the Lord to know the work.
What more be found believing more?
Believing more.
Yes. What more believing more
than trying to walk?
Exactly.
Work on believing more. And as you believe more, you don't need to pray and fast for faith to generate its work. It will just generate its own work.
Because faith comes by hearing.
Yeah.
Hearing.
To just generate
so work on your believing more.
Work on your believing more. And it will generate the work it's meant to generate. Mm. Are we together? Praise God forevermore. Hallelujah to Jesus.
Amen.
You know, so faith does not end at belief. It actually begins at belief and ends at action. The heroes of faith seen in Hebrews chapter 11 from verse 4 to 39 were called so because they acted on what they believed and obtained a good report. You see, so we always think that faith is just a belief. No, faith actually begins at belief. That's the beginning point of faith. The end of faith is when we act on it. Are you getting what I'm saying? So don't abrupt your faith. Make sure your faith generates work for you. Make sure your faith takes to the point of work. Are you getting what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So it's not enough to agree and believe that Jesus is the Lamb. It's not enough to agree and believe that Jesus is the Lamb and light of God. We must act in faith by following Jesus, the Lamb and light of God. Same way disciples of John follow Jesus. Are we together? We must follow him as his disciples, the same way the disciples of John follow Jesus. So how do we know that we have finally fully believed that Jesus is the Lamb and the light of God? We become attained. Look at all the disciples of Jesus. They lived and died for Jesus, who they be. Peter was crucified upside down for the God. I read in the book of 2 Peter today, and I think it was chapter 1, when he said, I will soon put off this mortality and put on immortality. Then Jesus told me, I'm like, wow. You know, when I watched the cartoon, I saw that he was on a journey, and Jesus accosted him on the road and said, it's time for you to go. Because there were some young men who wanted to do not want to be disciples, who said, oh, please, Peter, we can whisk you out of this prison. He said, no. Jesus said, it's time for me to go. They are not whisking me anymore. I'm going back so I can go and die. And he told them, it's about time for me to die. Jesus told me, it's time for me to die. Can you imagine such statements? It was a level of followership, a level of this, a level of immune. That was the fullness of it. They had acted so much and they became followers. Apostle Paul said, I'm ready to be offered. See their statements. I'm ready to be offered. Peter said, I'm ready to put off mortality and put on immortality. They were just making this event as if it was a normal thing, you know, and it's waiting for people like us. But it's a level of what? It's a climax
of followership
that became a normal way of life, you know. This is the end of it. Being beside Jesus, that Apostle Paul said, for me to live is Christ and to die is
gain. Hallelujah. This is another wonderful session, and that brings us to the end of the study on verse 7 of John chapter 1. I believe we've received a lot, and we are still receiving your questions. So you can keep sending them in through the emails, or you drop them via this podcast. God bless you for listening to this session. Let's have a wonderful
prayer. Thank you, Lord, for another great time of fellowship. We thank you for teaching us today again. We ask, Lord, that we shall act on our faith in you.
Amen.
We shall act on our faith in you, Jesus, the Lamb.
Amen.
We shall be indeed disciples.
Yes, Lord.
Living for you and being ready to die. Thank you, in Jesus' name.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Now is your moment of salvation. If you are yet to make the Lord Jesus Christ your Lord and personal Savior, we request that you say this prayer along with many others now. Say these words: Lord Jesus, I am a sinner, I repent of my sins, and ask that you forgive my sins. I believe that you shed your blood on the cross, died for my sins, and rose again in the third day. Today, I invite you into my life today. Wash me by your blood, make me your own, and till eternity be my Lord and personal Savior. Thank you, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' precious name.
For your love gift of any amount to Grace Life Kami Podcast, kindly use any of our giving channels available to give in dollars. You can send to Universal Merchant Bank Ghana. Account number 033-154-551-2013. SWIFT code MBGHGHAC. To give in CDs, Universal Merchant Bank Ghana, you can send to account number 033-254-551-2017. To give in Naira, you can send to
Ecobank Nigeria, account number 554-102-0592. Also, for further enquiries, you can call us on +233-54-594-7132. Or send us an email via chimdiohahunaministry@gmail.com. Today, remain ever blessed.
We believe you were blessed listening to this teaching from God's Word. May your soul remain ever refreshed and revived. We would love to hear your praise report today. Beloved, remain connected to Grace Life Komi Podcast. Jesus is Lord.